وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال. وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. إن شاء الله تعالى I'm going to be speaking about and doing the tafsir of كلمة التوحيد. And what I plan to do inshallah ta'ala is to focus on three points regarding at-tawheed. I want to speak about fadluhu, its virtue. La ilaha illallah, the virtue that it has. Wa ma'nahu, its meaning. Wa ahmiyatuhu, and its importance. So three things inshallah ta'ala is what I'm going to be focusing on in this session, bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. And when you do finish this session, I hope that you understand the virtue that this word, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, it holds, and the meaning that is in it, and how important it is. Some of you might think to yourselves, I already know La ilaha illallah, I'm a Muslim. And so what I want to say to you is, it's a reminder. And the reminder benefits the believer. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَى تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Remind, for verily the reminder benefits the believer. So even if you know, it will be a reminder for you, and inshallah ta'ala, that will be إِذْنِ اللَّهِ الْكَرِيمِ benefit you. My beloved brothers and sisters who are listening, the Tawheed is awwal wajibin. It's the first obligation on every one of us. And it's not only the first obligation, rather it's the last obligation. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sent Mu'adh ibn Jabal to Yemen. Where did he send Mu'adh to? He sent Mu'adh to Yemen. And the Prophet said to Mu'adh, إِنَّكَ سَتَأْتِ قَوْمًا مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ. Mu'adh, you're going to come into contact with the people of the scripture. They are a people who have a scripture, they have a book, they have a religion. The Prophet said, فَلْيَكُنْ أَوَّلَ مَا تَدْعُوهُمْ. Let the first thing you call them to be what? شهادة أن لا إله إلا الله. Let the first thing that you call them to, and the first thing that you command them to come with, let it be لا إله إلا الله. So the messenger said, إنك ستأتي قوما من أهل الكتاب. You're going to come to a people of the scripture, the أهل الكتاب, either يهود or نصارى. فليكن, let it be أولا, the first thing. تدعوهم, that you call them to be what? شهادة أن لا إله إلا الله. Let that be the first thing that you call them, that you call them to. And every prophet, every messenger who came, this is what he called his nation and his people to. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he tells us in the Quran, إِذْ جَاءَتْهُمُ الرُّسُلُ مِنْ بَيْنِ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Prophets, before and after, those who came, all of them, they called their people to, and they started their message with, by saying what? أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Don't worship anyone other than Allah Azza wa Jalla. La ilaha illallah. Every prophet said to his nation and his people, يَا قَوْمِ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مَا لَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَهٍ غَيْرٍ. Worship Allah alone. You have no other Lord deserving of worship other than Allah Azza wa Jalla. Let him be the first one you... Let him be the one that you worship. So every prophet did that. And Nabiullah Muhammad, when he came to the people of Mecca and he started his message, the first thing that he called them to was what? La ilaha illallah. The salah, after 10 years of his prophecy, 10 years, the salah was made obligatory. The last 3 years in Mecca was when the salah was made obligatory. The Prophet was in Mecca for 13 years, 13 years. 10 years of that was only Tawheed. And then the salah came, which is the second pillar of Islam, in the last 3 years of Mecca. And then the Prophet still didn't stop calling to Tawheed, because the salah is the manifestation of La ilaha illallah. The salah is your action and your proof of La ilaha illallah, is that you stand up in front of Allah and that you pray five times a day. You put your face on the floor with complete love and complete humiliation for Him and humility. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had 13 years in Mecca and 10 years in Medina. He did not stop one day calling to Tawheed. So it's the first obligation that we need to come with. And it's the last. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, لَقِّنُوا مَوْتَاكُمْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Al-Imam Muslim narrated this hadith from two companions. The first companion is Abu Sa'id al-Khudri. And the second one is Abu Hurairah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said in this hadith, لَقِّنُوا مَوْتَاكُمْ. The one from amongst you who is on his deathbed, he's about to die, he's going to departure from this world, and he's no longer going to live, remind him to say the word, to say La ilaha illallah. Remind him. لَقِّنُوا مَوْتَاكُمْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. It's آخر واجب. It's the far last obligation. It was the first, and it was what? It is the last. That's the status and the position. ولذلك the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, من قال لا إله إلا الله. Anyone who says لا إله إلا الله. Bazzar narrated this بسنده على شرط إمام مسلم. بسند صحيح على شرط مسلم. Bazzar narrated this with a chain of narration which is صحيح. Rather, it's the condition of Imam Muslim. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, من قال لا إله إلا الله. Anyone who says La ilaha illallah, عِنْدَ مَوْتِهِ, when he's on his deathbed, he's about to leave the world, دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ, he will enter Jannah. يَوْمًا مِنَ الدَّهْرِ, one day. وَإِنْ أَصَابَهُ مَا أَصَابَهُ. The Prophet said, anyone who says La ilaha illallah, when he's on his deathbed, he will one day enter Jannah. Even if it happens to him, whatever happens to him. Meaning, if he even ends up going to the hellfire for a period of time, he will still go to Jannah one day. La ilaha illallah will take you to Jannah one day. La ilaha illallah, it has great virtues. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, أَفْضَلُ الدُّعَاءِ دُعَاءِ يَوْمِ عَرَفَةِ. The best supplication is the supplication of the day of Arafah. That's the best supplication. وَأَفْضَلُ مَا قُلْتُ أَنَا وَالنَّبِيُّونَ مِنْ قَبْلِي لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said, the best thing, me and all of the previous prophets, the best thing that we said, the best, is La ilaha illallah. أَفْضَلُ صِغَةُ الْمُبَالَغَةِ على وزن أفعل. The best. It's a superlative in the Arabic language. The greatest. The best thing that I and all the prophets that came before me said was لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. Al-Imam Tirmidhi narrated in a different wording, but the wording that I just narrated is narrated by Malik in his Muwatta. Al-Imam Malik narrated it in his Muwatta رحمه الله تعالى. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was one day asked, أَمِنَ الْحَسَنَاتِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Is La ilaha illallah from the hasanat, righteous deeds? Is it from it? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he responded and he said, "Hiya afdalul hasanat." It's not just from the good things. It's the greatest righteous deed that a person can come with, which is what? La ilaha illallah. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told us in a hadith that Nabiullah Nuh, he called his nation for 950 years. Da'wah for 950 years. When we look at the Quran and when we look at the Sunnah, we don't know anything of the da'wah of Nabiullah Nuh except that he called Tawheed. Brothers, pay attention here. This is a very important point. Nuh alayhi salam, Allah says, وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا نُوحًا إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِ فَلَبِثَ فِيهِمْ أَلْفَ سَنَةٍ إِلَّا خَمْسِينَ عَامًا. Nuh was sent to his people for 950 years. From the shara'i'ah, the legislations, and the rules and the regulations, we don't find them mentioned for Nabiullah Nuh, except that he called his people to what? At-tawheed. That's the thing that stuck. 950 years, there must have been other legislations that he gave his nation. Well, ashaka there were. But the Quran pointed out, and the Sunnah pointed out, that Nuh focused on making sure that his people understood and appreciated the word La ilaha illallah. And Nabiullah Nuh, 950 years calling his nation, not many people followed him, as Allah said, وَمَا آمَنَ مَعَهُ إِلَّا قَلِيلٌ. The ones who believed in Nuh were very little in number. The people that believed in Nuh were a group who can go on a ark, including animals as well. That's all that followed him. That doesn't mean that the da'wah of Nabiullah Nuh was wrong. That doesn't mean he didn't do what was told. He did exactly what he was told to do. And he followed the commandments of Allah Azza wa Jalla. But the religion is not about how many followers that you have and how many people are with you. It means to do what Allah is pleased with. So Nabiullah Nuh, he's very serious about Tawheed, La ilaha illallah, and its meaning. And look what he did on his deathbed. And Imam Muslim narrated in his Sahih that Nabiullah Nuh said to his children, he said, "Amurukum bila ilaha illallah. Amuruka bila ilaha illallah." He said it to his son, "I command you bila ilaha illallah." He's talking to his son on his deathbed. Nuh is just before he's about to die. He said to his son, "Amuruka bila ilaha illallah. Fa inna samawati sab'a wal aradina sab'a law wudi'at fi kiffatin wa wudi'at la ilaha illa Allah fi kiffatin rajahat bihinna la ilaha illa Allah." Nabiullah Nuh said, if the seven heavens were placed on one scale and the seven earth was placed on one scale, sorry, the seven heavens and the seven earths were both placed on one side of the scale, and La ilaha illallah was placed on the second side of the scale, La ilaha illallah will outweigh it. رَجَحَتْ بِهِنَّ La ilaha illallah. فَإِنَّ الْأَرَاضِ فَإِنَّ السَّمَوَاتِ السَّبْعَ. We're talking about the seven heavens. We are talking about the seven earths. La ilaha illallah will outweigh all of that. Brothers, if you look at the Quran today, you read from Surah Al-Fatiha, and then you read Surah Al-Baqarah, and then وَهَكَذَا. The Quran starts with which surah? Surah Al-Fatiha, right? That's why it's called the opening, Fatiha. The Quran starts from Fatiha. The first command that you will come to is يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اعْبُدُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. The first amr is U'budullah, worship Allah. La ilaha illallah. Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said, wherever you find the word U'budu Rabbakum in the Quran, it means a wahidullah, single Allah. La ilaha illallah. Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said that. Again, if you read the Quran from Surah Al-Fatiha, you open the Quran, And you start the Quran, the first prohibition, the first nahi that you're going to come to is, فَلَا تَجْعَلُوا لِلَّهِ أَنْدَادًا وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. Do not associate partners with Allah when you know. That's shirk. So the first thing that was commanded, if you look at the opening of the Quran, is what? التوحيد لا إله إلا الله. And the first prohibition is what? It's shirk. Allah referred to tawheed, la ilaha illallah. Allah referred to it as kalimatu tayyiba. Allah said, alam tara kayfa daraba Allahu mathalan kalimatan tayyibatan ka shajaratin tayyibatin asluha thabitun wa far'uha fi as-sama'. Allah said kalimatu tayyiba. Ibn Jarir at-Tabari rahimahullah, he said kalimatu tayyiba in this ayah means la ilaha illallah. Al-Rabi' ibn Anas, he said, أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا كَلِمَةً طَيِّبَةً كَشَجَرَةٍ طَيِّبَةٍ أَصْلُهَا ثَابِتٌ وَفَرْعُهَا فِي السَّمَاءِ كَلِمَةُ الطَّيِّبَةِ. الربيع بن أنس, he said it means لا إله إلا الله. Allah referred to كلمة التوحيد لا إله إلا الله as كلمة الطيبة. Allah also referred to it as كلمة التقوى, وألزمهم كلمة التقوى وكانوا أحق بها وأهلها. وألزمهم كلمة التقوى. كلمة التقوى هي, what does it mean? It means لا إله إلا الله. ابن جرير الطابري said that in his tafsir. وألزمهم كلمة التقوى. What is كلمة التقوى? It means لا إله إلا الله. Why is it called كلمة التقوى? What does تقوى mean, brothers, in the Arabic language? التقوى comes from the word الوقاية. What does وقاية mean? وقاية means to prevent yourself, to shield yourself from something. When you come with kalimatul tawheed, you come with al-wiqayatu min al-nar. You shield yourself from the hellfire. La ilaha illallah, what does it shield you from? It protects you and it shields you from the hellfire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he also referred to la ilaha illallah as what? Da'watul haq. Allah says, lahu da'watul haq. Lahu da'watul haq. Da'watul haq in this ayah, what does it mean? Da'watul haq means la ilaha illallah. Allah also referred to it as a haq. Just the word la ilaha haq. Allah referred to it as. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, وَلَا يَمْلِكُ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِهِ الشَّفَاعَةَ إِلَّا مَنْ شَهِدَ لَهُ إِلَّا مَنْ شَهِدَ بِالْحَقِّ وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. إِلَّا مَنْ شَهِدَ. Except the one who testifies with what? بِالْحَقِّ, with truth. Haq here means, it means la ilaha illallah. It means la ilaha illallah. So kalimatul tayyibah means la ilaha illallah. Wa alzamahum kalimatul taqwa wa kanu ahqqa biha wa ahlaha means la ilaha illallah. Lahu da'watul haq, it means la ilaha illallah. Abdullah ibn Abbas, Qatadah ibn Da'amah al-Sadusi, and others said it. And also lahu da'watul haq. The ayah Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, إِلَّا مَنْ شَهِدَ بِالْحَقِّ وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. It means لا إله إلا الله. لا إله إلا الله, my beloved brothers and sisters, it is a term because it has that station, because it has that position, and because it's something that we need to say regularly, and we need to say it continuously on our, it has to be on our tongue all the time. It's from those letters that every person can pronounce. La ilaha illallah, ponder over it. They are not from the huruf of the Arabic language, which are hard to be pronounced. The harf al-dad, it's hard to pronounce it. The harf kha, it's hard for some people to pronounce it. وَمَا إِلَىٰ ذَلِكَ. La ilaha illallah are from the huruf, which is simple for anyone to say. And it's easy. Also, number two. La ilaha illallah, if you, la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, if you ponder over it, you will realize that it's muhmala. It doesn't have no dots. La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, it doesn't have any dots. There's no dots. And the scholars, they said the reason why it doesn't have dots is the way that the dots were stripped from it, you need to strip shirk from yourself. And you need to strip those dots from your heart in associating partners with Allah. Then the shirk, what does it do? إِذَا أَذْنَبَ عَبْدِي ذَنْبًا نُكِتَتْ فِي قَلْبِهِ نُكْتَةً سَوْدًا. When the person commits a sin and goes against Allah's command, what happens to his heart? A black dot is placed. So the person, what does he do? He strips, the same way that the dots were stripped from La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, you strip from your heart associating partners with Allah. La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah is 7 words. How many words? 7 words. La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Counted. 7 words. And the scholars, they said, these 7 words are going to save you from the 7 doors of the hellfire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said about Jahannam, he said, لَهَا سَبْعَةُ أَبْوَابٍ لِكُلِّ بَابٍ مِّنْهُمْ جُزْءٌ مَقْصُومٌ. Jahannam has how many doors? Allah mentions that he has 7 doors. وَإِنَّ جَهَنَّمَ لَمَوْعِدُهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ. لَهَا سَبْعَةُ أَبْوَابٍ لِكُلِّ بَابٍ مِّنْهُمْ جُزْءٌ مَقْصُومٌ. Those 7 words, they will protect you from the hellfire. They will what? They will protect you from the hellfire. But the type of protection that they can protect you from the hellfire is in 2 ways. The first type of protection is bil-kulliyah, meaning you will not enter the hellfire at all, and it will take you to Jannah, and you will not fall into the hellfire. And the second protection it will do for you is it will protect you from everlasting in the hellfire. A group of people, even though they've come with La ilaha illallah, but because they have committed other crimes, they will end up in the hellfire. But La ilaha illallah still has so much power that it can still take you out of the hellfire. So even if your La ilaha illallah that you came with was weak, it will still protect you from, and it will still save you from staying in the hellfire forever. So La ilaha illallah has that position, brothers. And it has that position. Now that we've understood the virtue of La ilaha illallah, and there's so much other things that can be said about this word, I want to, inshallah ta'ala, want to go into its meaning. And I want to conclude with that, inshallah ta'ala. What is the meaning of La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah? Brothers, the word La at the beginning, in Arabic it's called Nafi. Nafi is what? It's a negation, you're negating. And in the Arabic language, grammatically in Nahu, the scholars of grammar, they mention La an-nafiyah, then La of negation. La, what did we just say right now? Is you're negating, you are refusing. The La an-nafiyah in the Arabic language are 2 types. This is very important that you understand this. La an-nafiyah that come in the Arabic language, في كلام العرب نوعان. It's how many types? It's 2 types. The first one, and I'm going to break it down, and you will understand once I finish explaining why I mention this. The first type is التي تعمل عمل ليس. The first one is called. So how many types of la did we say there were in the Arabic, the la of negations? There are 2 types. The first one is called la التي تعمل عمل ليس. The first la, it does, and it comes with the same things that ليس does. This la, it resembles and it's like and it plays the role of ليس. التي تعمل عمل ليس. What did ليس used to do in the Arabic grammar? Those of you who study Nahu, what does ليس do? So ليس, first of all, what does it enter? It enters a jumla ismiya, right? مبتدأ أنا الخبر. What does it, the ليس do to the مبتدأ and what does it do to the خبر? ترفع الإث ترفع الإث just رفع of the مبتدأ and it does نصب of the what? Of the خبر. So the Arabs they say ترفع الإسم وتنصب الخبر. So in the Arabic language the person will say ليس رجل قائما صح ليس رجل look at the last letter رجل قائما that's what ليس does right this لا it does the same thing you say the same thing you say لا رجل قائما it does the same thing as ليس But this type of negation, this type of negation, the first type, التي تعمل عمل ليس, that does the same thing as ليس. The scholars, they say, تنفي الوحدة وتحتمل العموم. It doesn't negate everything. For example, what did I just say? ليس الرجل, what did I just say? لا رجل قائما. No man is standing, right? This la, it only negated one man standing. So that means two men are standing, or three, or four, or five. So the la that comes as laysa, its negation is not strong. Does that make sense? It only negates one, but it doesn't negate all. That's why the scholars, they say, تنفي الوحدة وَتَحْتَمِلُ الْعُمُومِ And there's a possibility that you can negate everything. The second type, are we all, is this making sense to everybody? The second type of negation is الَّتِي تَعْمَلُ عَمَلَ إِنَّا This one does the, it resembles إِنَّا. إِنَّا is the opposite of ليسا. ليسا is from the أخوات to كان, right? إِنَّا what does it do? Inna does the opposite of what Laysa does, which was what? Inna, what does it do? It does tansibul isma. And what does it do? Watarfa'u, watarfa'u al-khabara. Are we all together? So what do you say? You say, inna rajulan qa'imun. Inna rajulan qa'imun. Verily, a man is standing, right? What did you say? إِنَّ رَجُولًا قَائِمٌ Like in the لا, it does the same job as the إِنَّ, so what does it become? لَا رَجُولًا أَمَ لَا رَجُولَ قَائِمٌ لَا رَجُولَ قَائِمٌ This type of لا, التي تعمل عمل إِنَّ, that does the same thing as إِنَّ. This one, it's called نفي جنس meaning when we say لا رجل قائم it means there's not one or two or three or four or five or six or ten or thousand or million are standing so the second type of negation is what عموم and it's نص في العموم meaning it shows that it's an ultimate negation And that's the one that is in Kalimatu Tawheed, La ilaha illallah. Does that make sense, brothers? The La in Kalimatu Tawheed is the second type, which is that when you say La ilaha, you're negating fully. Does that make sense? You're not saying there's two or three, no, any whatsoever. La ilaha illallah, Allah. Lakin. The scholars, they mention that the condition for the la to be inna or to resemble inna and not laysa, they mention seven conditions and Ibn Malik in his Alfiyah, he mentioned only two conditions. He says, عَمَلَ إِنَّ جَعَلْ لِلَّهِ فِي النَّكِرَةِ مُفْرَدَةً جَاءَتْكَ أَوْ مُكَرَّرَةً Ibn Malik, he mentions two conditions. One of the conditions I want to focus on here, I don't want to go too much into the other conditions because they don't concern us now. I only want to mention one. Pay attention. Come, please pay attention. I know I don't want to go too technical, and that wasn't my aim, but I really want to show you how important it is to understand this, because La ilaha illallah is Arabic. And if you feel you understand what is being said here, when you next time say La ilaha illallah, La ilaha illallah, La ilaha illallah, and you're doing your dhikr, you feel it in your heart. La here, brothers, we just said right now, it's what? It's the second type, and this is nafyu jinsin. You're negating any ilah other than Allah Azza wa Jalla. Are we all together? You're negating that. But the condition, the scholars, they said, when do we say it's the first type of negation and the second type? How do we? Is that an easy question? Do you all understand that question? How many types of negation of la did we mention? Two. The first one we said is التي تعمل عمل ليس. And the second one we said is التي تعمل إنا. We said that, right? When do we put it in the first category? And when do we put it in the second category? The scholars, they said it's placed in the second category, the strong negation, when it meets seven conditions. And the great grammarian Ibn Malik, he didn't mention seven, he only mentioned two. He managed to actually mention one, but within that one, two comes under it. I'm not going to mention all of them. I'm only going to mention one condition, because that's what I want to focus on. One of the conditions is the ism and the khabar. Both of them have to be nakira. They have to be indefinite. Does that make sense? The ism that la is using, the noun that la is using, and the khabar, both of them have to be indefinite. Listen to what I just said right now. La rajula. Rajul here, is it a man you know, or is it indefinite man? Huh? Indefinite. La rajul. Rajul is indefinite. If I said ar-rajul, oh, now it becomes definite. It's the man. Are we all together, brothers? Here is la rajul. La rajula. So what do you learn from that? You learn from here is that the rajul is indefinite, and qa'im, of course, is indefinite. That's no problem. Let's go to kalimatul tawheed, because we said kalimatul tawheed is the second type, right? La ilaha. Ilaha, is it indefinite or is it definite? Haya illallah, Allah, haya, is it definite or indefinite? Is Allah indefinite or indefinite? Allah indefinite. See the way he said Allah is a'raful ma'arif. Allah can't be nakira. Allah. There's no one we know more better than Allah Azza wa Jalla. So the ism has to be nakira. And the khabar has to be nakira. And kalimatul tawheed, no, it's not. The khabar is actually a'raful ma'arif, which is Allah. So how did we say that it is the second type? Huh? How do we put it in the second type? This is where the scholars then said the khabar is not Allah. The khabar is not? The khabar here is haq. The word haq is the khabar. And then the scholar said, why did you choose the word haq for? Why did you bring the khabar as haq? Because they said, Allah said in the Quran, ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْحَقِّ وَأَنَّمَا يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِهِ هُوَ الْبَاطِلِ. Are we all together? And some said they bought a jar and a majroor, and they said bihaq wa ma ila dhalik. Lakin haq, one word is good. So what do we say? Now let's go back to the meaning. La ilaha, what does it mean? That there's no ilah that is deserving haq illallah, except Allah Azza wa Jalla. We bought the word haq as the khabar, right? To make it a nakira. And the reason why we chose haq specifically is because it's found in the Quran. Allah used that. ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ الْحَقِّ. Allah is haq, right? So we use the word haq. And the reason why we say it's a nakira is because haq can be used for other than Allah Azza wa Jalla. So since it can be used for other than Allah, it's not definite anymore. Does that make sense, brothers? La ilaha illallah means there is nothing that we worship. The word worship in the English language, I only use it to just make it close to you to understand. But it's not a correct translation for the word ibadah. Ibadah is bigger than worship. Ibadah, what does it mean? And then we're going to conclude, inshallah ta'ala. Ibadah, brothers, when you look at it, you have to look at it from two angles. How many angles do you have to look at it from? Two angles. The first angle that you need to look at it is, how would you do the ibadah? How do you do something? The scholars, they mention, if you're doing something for Allah Azza wa Jalla, you need to do it with complete love. And you need to do it with complete what? Humility and humiliation and humbleness. For example, we take our face, we put it into the floor. Who are we doing this for? Allah. We've put ourselves low. Sah? So we humbled ourselves. But when you're doing it, are you in love with Allah? Are you in love with Allah? Of course. You're doing it for love. You may be forced by someone who say to you, prostrate to me. And out of fear, you may prostrate to him. But are you doing it with love? So he can never get those two. The only one who can get those two is Allah Azza wa Jalla. ولذلك ابن القيم says it is نونية وعبادة الرحمن غاية حبه وخضوع قاصده هما قطبان وعبادة الرحمن غاية حبه وخضوع قاصده هما قطبان. Complete love and complete humility. For who? For Allah Azza wa Jalla. That's how you do the ibadah. Here the second thing is, what is a ibadah? What can I say this is a ibadah? The scholars, they said, ibadah is ismun jami' li kulli ma yuhibbuhu Allah wa yardah min al-aqwali wal-a'mal al-zahirati wal-batina. Ibadah is speech. Ibadah is actions. So ibadah can be what? Speech. It can also be what? Actions. This actions are external and what? Internal. And also the scholars, they believe the speech is external and internal. Four, speech has two comes out from it, external and internal, and action, two come out of it, which is what? External and? How do we know that Allah loves this action? How do we know that this action is a ibadah? Allah has to love it and Allah has to be pleased with it. It's speech and it's actions. Allah loves it and he's what? How do we know Allah loves it and Allah is pleased with it? The scholars here, they say, only through the Prophet. None of us here has met Allah. None of us have. The only way that we know Allah loves this and that this is pleasing to him subhanahu wa ta'ala is through the Prophet. At-turuqu kulluha masduda. All of the roads are blocked. All of the roads are closed. The only road that is open to Allah is the road that Nabi Muhammad took. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, ibadah is built on what Allah loves and what he's pleased with. It can be speech and it can be... Once it meets that definition I gave you, you are not allowed to divert it for anyone other than Allah Azza wa Jalla. That's haqqullahi. It's the right Allah has over his creation. Allah said in the Quran, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهِ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا إِمَّا يَبْلُغَنَّ عِنْدَكَ الْكِبَرَ أَحَدُهُمَا أَوْ كِلَاهُمَا فَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا أُفٍّ وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا وَقُلْ لَهُمَا قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا وَاخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا. In another ayah, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he said, وَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِي شَيْءٍ وَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ. So you have to learn the word ibadah and what it means in order to understand La ilaha illallah. There is many more things that can be said. And there's many other things that I had in mind to cover, which were the conditions of La ilaha illallah. The conditions and the prerequisites that are needed for a person to come with. But the time is short, and I don't like to lengthen a topic I want everyone to understand. If I go for longer, you lose concentration. I think that is enough, inshallah ta'ala, for today. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me, a shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.